Hello students, I am Dr. Mazhar Ali, the Artificial Intelligence course instructor. I welcome you back to a course in Introduction to Artificial Intelligence of Department of Computer Science. We meet after about 3 months as we all were disturbed by the COVID-19 and still we are disturbed by the COVID-19. As per Higher Education Commission guidelines, we are starting our online courses from where we left. As we are passing our time in the COVID-19, so we cannot conduct the traditional classes. So Higher Education Commission has decided to get the classes online. And following the guidelines of the Higher Education Commission, our university has also decided to take classes online. So, dear students, last time we took a look at Introduction to Information Technology, Introduction to Artificial Intelligence, different domains of artificial intelligence, intelligent agents, searching methods, and expert systems in particular. Where we have AI agents that are trying to solve some sort of problem by taking actions in some sort of environment. Whether that environment is trying to take actions by playing moves in a game, or whether those actions are something like trying to figure out where to make turns in order to get driving directions from point A to point B, and so on. So today we will discuss on topic knowledge, knowledge-based systems. What is the role of knowledge base for the intelligent systems or expert systems? This time we are going to turn our attention more generally to just this idea of knowledge. The idea that a lot of intelligence is based on knowledge, especially if we think about human intelligence. People know the information. We know facts about the world, and using that information that we know, we are able to draw conclusions, reason about the information that we know in order to figure out how to something, or figure out some other pieces of information that we conclude based on the information we already have available to us. So, according to Merriam-Webster, the knowledge is basically the fact or condition of knowing something with a familiarity gained through experience or association. Sorry. We would like to focus on now is the ability to take this idea of knowledge and being able to reason based on knowledge and apply those ideas to artificial intelligence systems. In particular, we are going to be building what are known as a knowledge-based agents. Agents that are able to reason and act by reasoning knowledge internally. As somehow, inside of our artificial intelligence systems, they have some understanding of what it means to know something. And ideally, they have some algorithms or some techniques they can use based on the that knowledge that they know in order to figure out the solution to a problem or figure out some additional piece of information that can be helpful in some sense. So what do we mean by reasoning based on knowledge to be able to draw conclusions? Well, let's look at some rules or some examples. We take one sentence that we know to be true. If it didn't rain, then Aslam visited Hyderabad today. So one fact that we might know about the world. So first rule tells us, if it will rain, then Aslam will not visit the Hyderabad, or Aslam will not go to the Hyderabad. But if it will not rain, then Aslam will visit the Hyderabad. And then we take another fact. Aslam visited Hyderabad or Sakhar today, but not both. Means Aslam have visited only Sakhar or Hyderabad. So it tells us something about the world, that Aslam either visited Hyderabad but not Sakhar. So Aslam visited Sakhar but not Hyderabad as well. And now we have a third piece of information about the word that Aslam visited Sakhar today. Means Aslam has visited only Sakhar today. So we now have a three pieces of information. Three pieces means the three facts inside of the knowledge base, or three rules inside of the knowledge base, so to speak. Information that we know, and now we as humans can try and reason about this and figure out based on this information what additional information can we begin to conclude. Looking at these last two statements, Aslam either visited Hyderabad or Sakhar, but not both. And we know that Aslam visited Sakhar today as per the third statement or as per the third rule which is available in the knowledge base. Then it's a pretty reasonable that we could draw the conclusion that you know what? Aslam must not have visited Hyderabad today. Because based on the combination of these two statements, we can draw this inference. We can draw the conclusion. So to speak, a conclusion that Aslam did not visit Hyderabad today, but what? Aslam visited Sakhar today. But it turns out we can even do a little bit better than that. Get some more information by taking a look at this first statement and reasoning about that. This first statement says, if it didn't rain, it is a conditional. If it didn't rain, then Aslam visited Hyderabad today. So what does that mean? In all cases where it didn't rain, then we know that Aslam visited Hyderabad. But if we also know now that Aslam did not visit Hyderabad, then it tells us something about our initial premises. Because conclusions are drawn from the premises. So, we were thinking about the situations, about the rules. So, in particular, it tells us that it did rain today. Because we can reason, if it didn't rain, that Aslam would have visited Hyderabad. But we know for a fact that Aslam did not visit Hyderabad today. So, dear students, it's this kind of a reasoning. Reasoning on the basis of the rules which are available in the knowledge base. These five are the rules. These five are the facts. Therefore, that's why it's this kind of the reasoning, that sort of logical reasoning where we use logical based on the information that we know in order to take information and reach the conclusions. That is going to be the focus of what we are going to be talking about today. How can we make our artificial intelligence systems logical so that they can perform the same kinds of deduction, the same kind of reasoning that we have been doing so far. Of course, humans reason about logic generally in terms of human language that I just now was speaking in English, talking in English about these sentences which I mentioned in the previous slide, and trying to reason through how it's that they are related to one another. We are going to need to be a little bit more formal when we turn our attention to computers and be able to encode this notion of logic and truthhood and falsehood inside of machine. So logic is basically it includes the logical and the mathematical analysis of programs. With such analysis, one can prove the correctness of procedures and estimate the number of states required to execute a specified program. So we are going to introduce a few more terms and few symbols that will help us reason through this idea of logic inside of artificial intelligence system. And we will begin with the idea of a sentence. Now, a sentence in a natural language or in a human language like English or Urdu or Sindhi or Balochi or Pashto or any language is just something that I am saying, like what I am saying right now. In the context of artificial intelligence, though, a sentence is just an assertion about the word in what we are going to call a knowledge representation language. Some way of representing knowledge inside of our computers. Propositional logic. The way that we are going to spend most of today reasoning about knowledge is through a type of logic known as a propositional logic. There are several different types of logic, some of which we will touch on in this lecture, but propositional logic is based on a logic of propositions or just statements about the world. So we begin in propositional logic with the notion of propositional symbols. Let's visit the slide. We will have certain symbols that are oftentimes just letters, something like P or Q or R, where each of those symbols is going to represent some facts or sentences about the word. So P, for example, might represent that the fact that it is raining. And so P is going to be a symbol that represents that idea that it is raining. And Q, for example, might represent a slum visited Hyderabad today. So each of these propositional symbols represents some sentence or some fact about the word. But in addition to just having individual facts about the word, we want some way to connect these propositional symbols together in order to reason more complexity about other facts that might exist inside of the word in which we are reasoning. So in order to do that, we will need to introduce some additional symbols that are known as logical connectives. Now there are a number of these logical connectives, but we have taken only the five of those important logical connectives, and those ones we are going to focus on today in this lecture are these five up here. Each logical connective represented by a logical symbol. For example, not is represented by this symbol here, the symbol of the negation. And another, for example, and is represented by a symbol is sort of an upside down. And another is an or. Or connective is represented by a V shape symbol. And another connective is an implication. Oh, we will talk about implication, what that means in just a moment. Implication is represented by an arrow. And biconditional connective is represented by a two-sided or double-sided arrow. Definitely, we will discuss the biconditional soon in the coming slides. But these five logical connectives are the main ones we are going to focusing on in terms of thinking about how it is that computer can reason about that facts and draw conclusions based on the facts that it knows. But in order to get there, we need to take a look at each of these logical connectives and build up an understanding of what it is that they actually mean. So let's go ahead and begin with the not symbol. this not symbol here in the truth table. And what we are going to show for each of these logical connectors is what we are going to call a truth table. A truth table is a table that demonstrates what this word does not mean when we attach it to a positional symbol or any sentence inside of our logical language. And so the truth table for not is shown right here. If P, some propositional symbol or some other sentence even, is a false, then not P is a true. And if P is a true, then not P is a false. So definitely not P is giving results in opposite of the P. If P is a false, then the not P will be true. Not P is a negation of the P. If I call 1, means 0. So, as you might expect, if P is a false, meaning it, the sentence it is raining is a false, then the sentence not P must be true. Means if P is showing it's raining, the sentence that it is not raining in the negation P or the not P will show the sentence that it is not raining. Therefore, it is a true. So not you can imagine just takes whatever is in a P and it inverts it. So it turns false into true and true into false. Much analogously to what the English word not means. Just taking whatever comes after it and inverting it to mean the opposite. For example, P is equal to 1. The not P will be the opposite of 1, and the opposite of 1 is a 0. And if the P is equal to 0, the not P will be 1. So this truth table shows the process of the not or negation, that how negation gives the result on the original values. And also, a very English-like is this idea of "and," represented by this upside-down shape or this point shape. Is opposite to just taking a single argument the way "not" does. We have P and we have not P, and is going to combine two different sentences and propositional logic together. So I might have one sentence P and another sentence Q, and I want to combine them together to say P and Q. And the general logic for what P and Q means means that both of its operands are true. So P is a true and also Q is a true. If both are not true, the result will be false. And so here, so what the truth table looks like. This time we have two variables P and Q, and when we have two variables, each of which can be in two possible states, true or false, definitely, that means two squared, four possible combinations of truth and falsehood. So we have P is a false and Q is a false. So we have P is a false and Q is a true. And P is a true and Q is a false, and then P and Q both are true, and those are the only four possibilities for what P and Q could mean. Now you may take it into words or in numbers as well. So those are the four positions or the categories or possibilities. In each of those situations, this third column here, P and Q, is telling us a little bit about what it actually means for P and Q to be true. And we see that the only case where P and Q is true is in this fourth row here, where P happens to be true and Q also happens to be true. And in all other situations, P and Q is going to evaluate to be false. So this again is much in line with what our intuition of and might mean. If I say P and Q, I probably mean that I expect both P and Q to be true. For example, I am calling Zahid and Muneeb come to me. Means I call you both, not the single one. So if single one come, means this is a false. But if Zahid and Muneeb will come, then it's a true. So same here. If true and true, the P and Q is it true, or 1 and 1 is it true, or 1 into 1 is equal will be 1, and 0 into 0 will be 0, and 0 into 1 will be 0, and 1 into 0 will be 0, and same with the false and true. Next up, also potentially consistent with what we mean is this word or represented by this V shape. So this is a R, a sort of an upside. The symbol is a sort of an upside down and symbol and, or as the name might suggest, is a true if either of its argument is a true. So it is a different than the AND operator or AND connect the logical operand. As long as P is a true, for example, in R, I'm discussing about R. If P is a true or Q is a true, then P or Q is going to be true. This means the only time that P or Q is a false is if both of its operands are false. Means P is a false and Q is a false, then P or Q will automatically be false. Or P is a 0 and Q is a 0, then P or Q will automatically be Q. If P is a false and Q is a false, then P or Q is going to be false. But in all other cases, if at least one of the operands is a true, maybe they are both true, in which case P or Q is going to evaluate to true. Now this is mostly consistent with the way that most people might use the word, or in the sense of speaking the word or in normal English. Though there is sometimes when we might say where we mean P or Q, but not both. Or we mean sort of it can only be one or the other. It is important to note that this symbol here, this or means P or Q or both, that those are totally okay. As long as either or both of them are true, then the or is going to evaluate to be true as well. So it's only in the case where all of the operands are false that P or Q ultimately evaluates to false as well. So in logic, there's another symbol known as the exclusive R, which includes this idea of exclusively of, like one or the other, but not both. But we are not going to be focusing on exclusive R today. Whenever we talk about or, we are always talking about either or both in this case, is represented by this truth table here. For example, false, false. If P is a false, Q is a false, then P or Q will automatically be false. For example, I say Zahid or Muneeb come to me and both are not coming to me, the P or Q will be false. But if I say Zahid or Muneeb come to me and only Zahid come to me, that definitely condition is a true, because I say any one of you may come or you two may be come to me. Same if one is a Zahid and again Q is a Muneeb and both are coming to me, then it's the logic will be true. So any of the argument of P or Q appears, then it will be true. So, and the What we might call implication, now we will discuss the implication. Why we are calling it the implication is because as a denotator by this arrow symbol, so we have P and Q, means P implies the Q. So this sentence here will generally read as a P implies Q. And what P implies Q means is that if P is a true, then Q is also true. The statement P is implies Q means that if P is a true, then Q must also be true. The statement P implies Q is also written if P then Q, or sometimes Q if P in a turn. So a statement P is called the pyramids of implication and Q is called the conclusion. So I might say something like if it is a raining, for example, P is equal to it is a raining, then I will be indoors. Meaning it is a raining implies I will be indoors is the logical sentence that I am saying there. And the truth table for this can sometimes be a little bit tricky. So obviously if P is a true and Q is a true, then P implies Q, that's a true as well. So that definitely make sense. And it should also stand to reason that when P is a true and Q is a false, then P implies Q is a false. Because if I say to you, if it is a raining, then I will be indoors. And it is a raining, but I am not indoors, I am outdoors. So well, then it would seem to be that my original statement was not true. So P implies Q means that if P is a true, then Q also needs to be true. And if it is not well, then the statement is a false. Also worth noting though is what happens when P is a false, means it is not raining. When P is a false, the implication makes no claim at all. If I say something like, if it is a raining, then I will be indoors, and it turns out it's not raining, then in that case, I am not making any statement as to whether or not I will be indoors or not. So P implies Q just means that P is a true, Q must be true. But if P is not true, then we make no claim about whether or not Q is a true. So in either case, if P is a false, it doesn't matter what Q is, whether it's a false or true. But Q may be anything, false or true. So we are not making any claim about Q whatsoever. We can still evaluate the implication to true. The only way that the implication is ever false is if our premise P is true, but the conclusion what we are drawing Q happens to be false. So in that case, we would say P does not imply Q in the case. Exactly. If, for example, in P is false, means it is not raining. Q is well false because Q is not indoors. So P implies Q is true because Q is not bound to P. For example, I say to you, if it is raining, you have to stay at home. Like at the time of the COVID-19, in the COVID-19, stay at the home. So if it is raining, you have to stay at home. But if it is not raining, now it depends on you, either you are staying at home or not. So in the first line, P is false, means it is not raining. So now Q is independent, either it is staying at home or going out. So the implication shows the results true. And again, if P is false, means it is not raining, and Q is true, means Q is indoors, then the also condition is true, as I told you first. Okay, if it is not raining, it depends on you, either you are going out or not. But if P is true, means it is raining, and Q is a false, then definitely P will not implicate the Q and the result will be false because it is raining. But Aslam is going out, or you are going out. So definitely P implies Q is a false. And if P is in the fourth one, if P is a true, means it is a raining, and Q is also true, means Aslam is indoors. At home, the P implies Q will be true. Finally, the last connective that we will discuss is this biconditional. You can think of a biconditional as a condition that goes in both directions. So originally when I said something like, if it is raining, then I will be indoors. I didn't say what would happen if it wasn't raining. Maybe I'll be indoors, maybe I'll be outdoors. So this biconditional you can read as an if and only if. This is a conditional totally. So I can say I will be indoors if and only if it is raining. Meaning if it is raining, then I will be indoors. And if I am indoors, it's reasonable to conclude that it is also raining. So this biconditional is only true when P and Q are the same. So if P is true and Q is true, then this biconditional is also true. So P implies Q. But also the reverse is true. Q also implies P because it is a biconditional. So if if P and Q both happen to be false, we would still say it's a true. But in any of these other two situations, this P if and only if Q is going to ultimately evaluate to false. So lot of truths and falses going on there, but these five basic logical connectives are going to form the core of the language of propositional logic, the language that we are going to use in order to describe ideas, and the language that we are going to use in order to reason about those ideas, in order to draw conclusions or get the results. So let's now take a look at some of the additional terms that we will need to know about in order to go about trying to form this language of propositional logic and writing artificial intelligence that's actually able to understand this sort of logic. The next thing we are going to need is the notion of what is actually true about the world. We have a whole bunch of propositional symbols, P and Q and R and maybe others, but we need some way of knowing, like, what actually is true in the world. Is P true or false? Is Q true or false? And so on and so forth. And to do that, we will introduce the notion of model. A model just assigns a truth value where a truth value is either true or false to every propositional symbol. In other words, it's creating what we might call a possible world. So let me give an example. This is the example of the model. If, for example, I have two propositional symbols, P, that means it is raining, and Q, that means it is a Tuesday. A model just takes each of these two symbols and assigns a truth value to them, either true or false, or either one or zero. So here's here's a sample model. In this model, in other words, in this possible world, it is possible that P is true, meaning it is raining, and Q is false, meaning it is not a Tuesday. But there are other possible worlds or other models as well. So there is some model where both of these variables are true. Some models where both of these variables are false. In fact, if there are n variables that are propositional symbols like this and that are either true or false, then the number of possible models is true or to the n. Because each of these possible models, possible variables within my model could be said to either true or false if I don't know any information about it. So now that I have the symbols and connectives that I am going to need in order to construct these parts of knowledge, we need some way to represent the knowledge. And to do so, we are going to allow our artificial intelligence system access to what we will call a knowledge base. Knowledge base is a set of sentences or set of rules known by a knowledge base agents. A knowledge base is really just a set of sentences that just a set of the rules that our AI systems or AI agents knows to be true. Some set of sentences or some set of rules in propositional logic that are things that our AI knows about the world. And so we might tell our artificial intelligent agents or artificial intelligence systems some information about a situation that it finds itself in, or situations about a problem that it happens to be trying to solve. And we would give that information to the artificial intelligence systems or agents that the AI agents would store inside of its knowledge base. And what happens next is the AI agents would like to use that information in the knowledge base to be able to draw conclusions about the rest of the world. And what do those conclusions look like? So, well, to understand those conclusions, we will need to introduce one more idea, one more symbol, and that is the notion of entailment. This sentence here with this double tone style and these Greek letters. This is the Greek letter alpha and the Greek letter beta. And we read this sentence or rule as alpha, alpha entails beta. And alpha and beta here are just sentences or rules in propositional logic. And what this means is that alpha entails beta means that in every model, in other words, in every possible word in which sentence is a true, or sentence is alpha is true, then sentence beta is also true. So if something entails something else, if alpha entails beta, it means that if I know alpha to be true, then beta must be true, therefore also be true. So if my alpha is something like I know that it is a Tuesday in January, then a reasonable beta might be something like I know that it is a January. So because in all words, where it is a Tuesday in a January, I know for sure that it must be January, just by definition. So this first statement or sentence about the word entails the second statement, and we can reasonably use deduction based on that first sentence to figure out that the second sentence is in fact true as well. Ultimately, it's this idea of entailment that we are going to try and encode into our computer. We want our AI agent to be able to figure out what possible entailments are. We want our AI agent to be able to take these three sentences like if it didn't rain, Aswam visited Hyderabad, that Aswam visited Hyderabad or Sakhar, but not both. And that Aswam visited Sakhar. And just using that information, we would like our AI agent to be able to infer or figure out that using these three sentences inside of knowledge base, we can draw some conclusions. In particular, we can draw the conclusions here that one Aslam did not visit Hyderabad today. And we can draw the entailment too, that I did in fact rain today. And this process is known as the inference. And that's what we are going to be focusing on today. This process of driving new sentences from old ones, that I give you these three sentences, you put them in the knowledge base, and the AI and the AI are able to use some sort of inference algorithm to figure out that these two sentences must also be true. And that is how we define inferences. So let's take a look at an inference example to see how we might actually be about inferring things in a human sense before we take a more algorithmic approach to see how we could encode this idea of inference in AI. And we will see there are a number of ways that we can actually achieve this. So again, we will deal with a couple, again, definitely we will discuss in the coming slide. We will deal with a couple of propositional symbols here in this slide. We will deal with the P, we will deal with Q, and we will deal with the R. So P is basically, it is a Tuesday, and Q is it's running, and R is Aslam will go for a run. Means there are three rules, or three sentences. So three prepositional symbols that we are just defining to mean this. We are not saying anything about whether they are true or false. So we are just defining what they are. Now we will give ourselves or an AI agent access to a knowledge base, abbreviated to KB. So KB is the abbreviation of knowledge base. To the knowledge that we know about the word, we know this statement. So let's try to parse it. The parentheses here are just used for precedent, so we can see what associated with what. But you would read this as a P and Q, a P and not Q, implies R. So what does that mean? Let's put it piece by piece. P is, basically P is, it is a Tuesday, and Q is, it's a raining. So not Q will be, it is a not raining, because not Q means the negation of the P in form of the Q, and implies R is a Aslam will go for a run. So the way to read this entire sentence in a human natural language, at least, is if it is a Tuesday and it is not raining, then Aslam will go for a run. So if it is a Tuesday and it is not raining, then Aslam will go for a run. And that is now inside of our knowledge base. Means these rules are inside of our knowledge base. And let's now imagine that our knowledge base is two other pieces of information as well. It has information that P is a true, that it is a Tuesday, and we also have the information not Q, that it is not raining. This sentence Q, it is a raining, happens to be false. And those are the three sentences that we have access to P. P and not Q implies R, so P and not Q. Using that information, we should be able to draw some inference. P and not Q is only true if both P and not Q are true. So we know that P is true because it is a Tuesday, and we know that not Q is also true. So we know that this whole expression is true, and the definition of implication is if this whole thing on the left is true, then this thing on the right must also be true. So if we know that P and not Q is true, then R must be true as well. So the inference we should be able to draw from All of this is that R is a true, and we know that Asram will go for a run by taking this knowledge inside of our knowledge base and being able to reason based on that idea. So this ultimately is the beginning of what we might consider to be some sort of inference algorithm. Some process that we can use to try and figure out whether or not we can draw some conclusions. And ultimately what these inference algorithms are going to answer is the general question about entailment which we discussed already. So given some query about the word, something we are wondering about the word, and we will call that query alpha. The question we want to ask using these inference algorithm is, does it KB means our knowledge base, entail alpha? In other words, using only the information we know inside of our knowledge base, the knowledge that we have access to, can we conclude that the sentence alpha is true? And that's ultimately what we would like to do. So how can we do that? How can we go about writing an algorithm that can look at this knowledge base and figure out whether or not this QB alpha is actually true? Well, it turns out there are a couple of different algorithms for doing so, and one of the simplest perhaps is known as a model checking. So how can we do that? How can we go about writing an algorithm that can look this knowledge base and figure out whether or not this QB alpha is actually true? So now remember that a model is just some assignment of all of the propositional symbols inside of our language to a truth value, true or false. And you can think of a model as a possible word. That there are many possible words where different things might be true or false, and we can enumerate all of them. And the model checking algorithm does exactly that. So does our model tracking algorithm do? So what does our model tracking algorithm do? If we wanted to determine if our knowledge base entails some QB alpha, then we are going to enumerate all possible models. In other words, consider all possible values of true and false for our variables, or all possible states in which our word can be in. And if in every model where our knowledge base is true, alpha is also true, then we know that knowledge base entails alpha. So let's take a closer look at that sentence and try and figure out what it actually means. If we know that in every model, in other words, in every possible word, no matter what assignment of true and false to variable you give it, we know that whether our knowledge is true, what we know to be true. Is it true? So that this query alpha is also true. Well, then it stands to reason that also along as our knowledge base is true, then alpha must also be true. And so this is going to form the foundation of our model checking algorithm. So we are going to enumerate all of the possible words and ask ourselves, whenever the knowledge base is true, is alpha true? And if that's the case, then we know alpha to be true, and otherwise there's no entailment. Our knowledge base does not entail alpha. All right. So this is a little bit abstract, but let's take a look at an example to try and put a real propositional symbols to this idea. So again, we will work with the same example. Now in the model checking, if we look, if in every model where our knowledge base is a true, alpha is also true, then we know that knowledge base entails alpha. So let's take a closer look at that sentence and try and figure out what it actually means. So if we know that in every model, in other words, in every possible word, no matter what assignment of true and false to variable you give, if we know that whenever our knowledge is a true, so what we know to be true is a true, that this query alpha is also true. Well, then it stands to reason that as long as our knowledge base is a true, then alpha must also be true. So this is going to form the foundation of our model checking algorithm. We have to see what does our model checking algorithm do. If we wanted to determine if our knowledge base entails some query alpha, then we are going to enumerate all possible models. In other words, consider all possible values of true and false for variables, all possible states in which our word can be in. So this is going to form the foundation of our model checking algorithm. We are going to enumerate all the possible words and ask ourselves, where our the knowledge base is a true, is alpha true? And if that's the case, then we know alpha to be true, and otherwise there is no entailment. Our knowledge base does not entail alpha. So this is a little bit abstract, but let's take a look at an example to try and put real propositional symbols to this idea. So again, we will work with the same example. The same example means we have three arguments, variables P, Q and R, where P is a Tuesday, Q is it is a raining, or is as when we go for a run. So our knowledge base contains these pieces of information. P and not Q implies R. We also know P, it is a Tuesday, and not Q, it is not raining, and our query alpha, in this case the thing we want to ask is R. We want to know, is it guaranteed? Is it entailed that Aswam will go for run? So the first step is to enumerate all of possible models. We have three propositional symbols here, P, Q and R, which means we have 2 to the third power of 8 possible models. All false. False, false, true, false, true, false, false, true, true, etc. So 8 possible ways you could assign true and false to all of these models. So the first step is to enumerate all possible models as these all are the here, and we might ask in each one of them, is the knowledge base true? Here are the set of things that we know. In which of these words could this include base possibly apply to? In which word this knowledge base true? In the knowledge base, for example, we know P. Like we know it is a Tuesday, This means we know that these first four rows where P is a false, none of those are going to be true. are going to work for this particular knowledge base. Our knowledge base is not true in those words. Likewise, we also know not Q. We know that it is not aligning. So any of these models where Q is a true, like these two and these two here, those aren't going to work either, because we know that Q is not true. And finally, we also know that P and not Q implies R, so which means that when P is a true, whether P is a true here and Q is a false in these two, then R must be true. And if ever P is a true, Q is a false, but R is a false, that doesn't satisfy this implication here. That implication does not hold true under those situations. So we could say that for our knowledge base, we can conclude under which of these possible words is our knowledge base, which make it true, and under which of the possible word is our knowledge base false. So it turns out there is only one possible word where our knowledge base is actually true. In some cases, there might be multiple possible words where the knowledge base is true. But in this case, it just so happens that there's only one possible word where we can identify, say something about our knowledge base. In this case, we would look at the query. The query of R, is R true? R is a true, definitely. And so, as a result, we can draw that conclusion. And so this is this idea of a model checking enumerate all the possible models and look in those possible models to see whether or not if our knowledge base is a true. Is the query in a question true as well? This process of trying to take a problem and figure out what propositional symbols to use in order to encode that idea or how to represent it logically is known as a knowledge engineering. That software engineers and AI engineers take problem and try and figure out how to distill it down into knowledge that is representable by a computer machine. And if we can take any general purpose problem, some problem that we find in the human world, and turn it into a problem that computers know how to solve as by using any number of different variables, then we can take a computer that is able to do something like model checking or some other inference algorithm and actually figure out how to solve that problem. And the purpose of the computer world or computer machine is to solve the problems of real world in which we are living. The artificial intelligence is performing a very significant role in figuring out or solving the problems of a real world. And definitely the knowledge based systems and the knowledge engineering are the significant part in this concern. So knowledge engineering is a field of artificial intelligence that creates rules to apply to data to imitate the thought process of a human expert. It looks at the structure of task or a decision to identify how a conclusion is reached. So for example, if you are going to develop any expert system, any intelligent agent, this knowledge base will be essential to run that intelligent agent or systems or the expert system, and definitely this lecture will also be helpful to you. Because you see, the knowledge base is basically the database of the rules, which is basically which provide you that domain knowledge. For any purpose you are developing the systems, or that may be the agents or the expert systems, you need the database of the rules, that is called the knowledge base. And definitely we need the explanation systems, the task knowledge, and that as well. So all of this has helped us to create artificial intelligence systems that are able to represent information about what it knows and what it doesn't know. Next time, though, we will take a look at how we can make our AI even more powerful by not just encoding information that we know for sure to be true and not to be true, but also to take a look uncertainty, to look at what happens if AI thinks that something might be probable, or maybe not very probable, or somewhere in between those two extremes, all in the pursuits of trying to build our intelligent systems to be even more intelligent. Well, see you next time. Take care. Thanks.